kind of like the balance everything we need to know about people of 20.
Okay, thank you. So, yes, but, where is the...
The pointer.
Yesterday I talked about this dual master effect and this head of optics picture of confinement. Today I will talk about this Kulomb 20 picture, which is realized with Coulomb gauge. And for this purpose I will use the Hamiltonian approach. And in fact this approach will also show how these pictures are connected with each other. Now this work was done with these people. Most of them are
PhD students or previous PhD
students.
You may ask why I'm using the Hamiltonian approach, because we are used nowadays to for a field theory this functional approach.
However, if you think of quantum mechanics,
it's much easier, for example, to solve the hydrogen atom
by means of the Schrödinger equation.
I think everybody can solve the Schrödinger equation for the hydrogen atom, but if I would ask you to find the exact solution for the hydrogen atom with the functional integral, you will have a hard time. It's really tough to get the solution for the functional integral. So the Hamiltonian approach is, in this case, more efficient than it seems to be also the case in non-conservative quantum field theory. Now, let me briefly remind you of the canonical approach to quantum field theory. You start with the action, which you all know, and then you use the gauge field as the coordinates, and you define the momenta in the standard way as the variation with derivative with respect to the velocities. And here, in the case of the gauge field, the momentum turns out to be the electric field. Then, what you find is that the momentum for the temporal component of the gauge field vanishes. And so, of course, it makes some bubbles. You want a canonical formulation. So, what you are doing then to go to Y gauge. And then the Hamiltonian you get is given here, it's given by the momentum square plus the non-linearity number of the field square. So it's another simple expression.
Now, when you do canonical quantization, it's like in quantum mechanics to replace the momentum by the derivative with respect to the coordinates. And there's one point to use while gauge. You use Gauss's law as the equation of motion, and you have to implement Gauss's law as a constraint to your wave function. What is here on the left hand side is the covariant derivative with x here on the momentum operator. In fact, this operator here on the left hand side is nothing but the generator of time independent gauge transformations. So Gauss's law, on the right hand side, you have here the charge of the matter fields. So in QCD, this is the charge of the quarks. Now, in the absence of matter fields, Gauss's law just implies that your wave function is gauge invariant. Now you can try to solve the Schrödinger equation with this gauge invariant Hamiltonian. And there have been attempts by several people, Claudio Johnson, who did quite a nice work on the Schrödinger equation for Young-Yin theory. There have been also activities in 2 plus 1 dimensions, but all these activities didn't really go far. Because it's very difficult to deal with gauge invariant wave functions. So it's much easier to fix the gauge, and then it turns out here in the case of QCD, Coulomb gauge is quite convenient. So. So when you go to Coulomb gauge, you are left with the transversal component of the gauge field. Now in QED, you know this is already the gauge invariant part of your theory, but in QCD this is unfortunately not the case. When you fix the gauge, you have to introduce or reduce the Vadier-Popov method in your scalar product for your wave functionals. This is standard Vadier-Popov method. Except that your wave function is here only over the remaining coordinates, in this case over the transversal gauge fields, and you get here the Vadier-Popov determinant in your integration measure. In the case of Coulomb gauge, the Vadier-Popov operator is given by the covariant derivative times the ordinary derivative. Then you spin your momentum operator in the transversal part, which is just given by the derivative with respect to this transversal coordinate left in Coulomb gauge, plus a longitudinal part. You plug this into Gauss's law and solve for the transversal part. And what you find then is an expression like this. This is not really an operator identity, but it's correct only when it acts on wave functionals. But that's sufficient. And you can replace it the Hamiltonian this P parallel by this expression, and what you then find is the gauge fixed Hamiltonian. It's given here by this expression. First, what you have here is you get the Vadier-Popov determinant in the kinetic part, which is now more complicated than the previous gauge invariant Hamiltonian. Then you get an extra term, the so-called Coulomb term, which comes from the P parallel square, from the kinetic part of the longitudinal momentum operator. And this term is quite complicated, the so-called Coulomb term. It contains twice the Vadier-Popov operator inverse. It's really difficult to read. And it's really difficult, but it's more complicated than the other terms. And then you have the scalar product, which I mentioned already here for your wave function. You have this Vadier-Popov determinant in the measure. And then you have to solve the Schrödinger equation, just like in quantum mechanics. Now, there's a long history with solving the Schrödinger equation in Coulomb gauge. It goes back to Dieter Schüttel. Man has used Gauss ansatzes for the wave function with some variation in current omega, which is determined by minimizing the energy, that is the expectation value of your Young-Yin Hamiltonian. Our approach differs from all what has been done in the past in several ways. In the ansatz for the wave function, in the treatment of the Vadier-Popov determinant, and in the renormalization. Now, the crucial point is, what previous people didn't do, they did not include here the Vadier-Popov determinant. When you ignore the Vadier-Popov determinant here in the kinetic term, you basically lose your confinement properties of the theory. This is really crucial. So our ansatz for the wave function is given by a Gaussian multiplied by the inverse Vadier-Popov determinant square root. Now, to motivate this ansatz, if you think of quantum mechanics, in quantum mechanics, if you want to describe the wave function of a particle in a spherical symmetrical potential in an S state, you make an ansatz for the wave function. The wave function is given by a Rayleigh wave function over R. then R is nothing but the square root of the Jacobian from the coordinate transformation from the Cartesian to the spherical coordinates. And when you go to Coulomb gauge, you basically also go from Cartesian to curvilinear coordinates, and the Fanier-Popov determinant is the Jacobian of this coordinate transformation. So we use this wave function, calculate the energy, minimize the energy with respect to this variational kernel. Now the advantage of including here this free factor is that your gauge propagator, your Coulomb propagator, is just given by the inverse of this kernel here up to a factor of 2, which makes life quite easy. Now when you solve this variational equation, what you find for this omega, which in fact represents the gluon quasi-particle energy, it goes asymptotically at large momentum like the photon energy, of course you would expect from asymptotic freedom, but in the low momentum regime it's diverging, and this you also expect, you shouldn't have free gluons in the infrared because of confinement. Now let's have a more detailed look on this variational problem. The equation which you get by taking the variation of your energy has the form given here, the first line. It looks like dispersion relation. This quality chi is the ghost loop, then there is a tadpole, and then there comes a term from this Coulomb term, which I have, which I got here from this pi parallel square. Now, it turns out when we do the numerical calculation in the, I should say another, to mention something else. I mean, when you have the wave function, the principle what you can, of course, calculate then is the ghost field function. However, it's very difficult to explicitly carry out this calculation. So what you do, basically expand this inverse operator in some series, do some approximation and resum the series. And then you don't find an explicit expression for G, but what you find is the Dyson-Schwinger equation for this propagator. So then you have to solve this equation which comes from the variation of the energy together with this Dyson-Schwinger equation for the ghost. And it's by no means clear or trivial that now these two equations should have a solution, because in principle you get only one equation from the variational principle, and the second equation comes of course because we are doing approximations. And then it's no longer clear that these two equations do have a solution, but unfortunately they do. So what we do, we write the ghost propagator in terms of the form factor over the Laplacian, and the Laplacian would be the Fadeev-Popov operator in QED. So this ghost form factor basically gives all the deviations of Young-Mead theory or Young-Mead theory from QED. Because the non-topological physics is contained here in the ghost form factor. Yeah? Form? They enter implicitly because we have the Fadeev-Popov determinant.
Sure.
But in principle, I do not have to introduce the ghost fields because I can just drop this determinant. And in fact, I don't introduce the ghost field at all. Mm. Okay.
Well, the wave function that you have contains only the gauge field and the ghost.
The wave functional that you are using as a trial wave functional contains only the gauge field and not the ghost.
That's correct. Contains only the gauge field, that's correct. So you don't have to introduce the ghost field at all. But still, this quantity, the vacuum expectation value of the inverse Fadeev Popov operator is the ghost propagator, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
In the first diagrammatic line, you have this straight double line.
Yeah.
Could you explain the meaning of
that? Yeah, the double line stands for this Coulomb, for this kernel in the Coulomb term, which is given by minus invariant Popov operator twice times the Laplacian, and again minus invariant Popov operator. Is this kernel? Right? So, expectation value. So it's something like a propagator, but it comes here from this Coulomb term from eliminating this parallel.
We are still in the pure blue sector.
Pure blue sector, I can later produce it. Yeah, I should have said this. Thank you. At the moment, I'm talking just about the gluon sector. Now it turns out that we do the numeric calculations that these terms you can actually forget in the gluon sector. But in the Quark sector, this Coulomb term is very important. If you eliminate, or if you forget about this Coulomb term, you have no parallelism value. So now the point is that you have to solve these two equations. You can solve them analytically in the infrared by making power law ansatz for these properties. So you are left with these two equations. And now you make the power law ansatz for the gluon energy omega and for the ghost form factor. You plug this into your equations, and then you find a sum rule for the infrared exponent. The infrared exponent of the gluon energy equals twice the infrared exponent of the ghost form factor plus 2 minus the number of dimensions. Now in 3 dimensions you find 2 solutions of your equation then. The first one here, both infrared exponents are 1, and this is the second one which you see in the brackets. So what you find when you solve then the equations numerically of the whole momentum regime, this is the gluon energy which I showed before, and this is the ghost form factor. And what one has assumed here, this I should stress, which is really important, when we solve this equation, we, somewhere here, you can hardly see it, we assume the so-called horizon condition, that is that the ghost form factor is infrared divergent, or its inverse at zero momentum is zero. This is a crucial assumption. We will later see that we need an infrared divergent ghost form factor in order to have confinement. This is basically the heart of the Kribov Zwanziger confinement scenario. If you don't have this condition fulfilled, then you don't have confinement. So now at this stage of the calculation, this condition is an input. But what you can do, a normalization group flow equation, that's why for this Coulomb problem. And then, let me just mention that, then you get out this horizon condition. And this horizon condition is also supported by the lattice calculation that we show later. So let me just skip this because I have no time to discuss this flow equation. But what is really interesting is the following. Coulomb gauge in QED we know as a physical gauge because it explicitly eliminates the gauge of invariant degrees of freedom. It is not the case in Damier theory. However, the ghost form factor has a physical meaning in Damier theory. Look, when we write the ghost propagator as a form factor over this Laplacian, then you can show that this ghost form factor, or more precisely its inverse, represents the dielectric function of the Damier's vacuum. Now, the horizon condition implies that the dielectric function vanishes at zero momentum in the infrared. And what you find, when the dielectric function is shown here, what you find is precisely the picture which you have in the MIT bag model. You have, at small distances, you have an ordinary vacuum with the dielectric constant being equal to 1, while in the vacuum outside the hadrons, you have a vanishing dielectric constant. But if you have a vanishing dielectric constant, then you know from Gauss's law, there are no free charges, so there are no color charges in this case, that means less confinement. A medium with the vanishing dielectric constant is a perfect dielectricum. And this is nothing as the dual superconductor. Now you see how you get here in this cube of 20er picture, this dual superconductor picture from the condensation of magnetic monopoles, which we have discussed yesterday. So this is the picture I showed yesterday. Now when you compare this to lattice, which are first results in 2 plus 1 dimensions, these were done by a PhD student in Tübingen, Roman Moyatz, who is now a lawyer in the EU in Brussels. This is the fluid energy. This is the Gauss form factor. What you see is the UV is correct, the infrared is also correct, but in the mid-momentum regime there is some discrepancy. The same thing we observe in 3 plus 1 dimensions. These are the lattice results in 3 plus 1 dimensions, and they can be nicely fitted by the so-called Kleber formula, is some mass given by this value here. It's really remarkable that the lattice paper follows so closely this Kleber formula, which was derived by Kleber by doing a careful analysis of the gauge fixing problem here in Coulomb gauge. I have no time to discuss this in more detail. Again, what you find here is the UV is correct, the infrared is almost perfect, but in the mid-momentum regime there is some strength missing. What is shown here is the inverse dual propagator, the inverse dual energy, this is the propagator instead of the energy which we have seen before. Now, you can improve the calculations by going beyond the Gaussian ansatz, using a wave functional which contains in the exponent also cubic and quartic terms. Then of course you have no longer a weak theorem. However, what you can do, you can exploit Dyson-Schwinger equations to express these variational kernels which you have here in the exponent of your wave functional, or you can relate these kernels to your endpoint functions. And then you can again carry out the variational principle. And what you find then is this full black curve, which now fits much better the lattice data than the previous calculation which we did with the Gaussian functional. Now the Gauss form factor. Remember, we had an infrared exponent which was equal to 1 for the Gauss form factor in the continuum. Our first lattice calculation, we get 1/2. I was really somehow, I couldn't understand this result because it violates the sum rule which we have obtained for the infrared exponents. But the point is, calculating the Gauss form factor on the lattice is a very difficult problem, in particular concerning the infrared behavior. And I mean, I have no time to discuss it in detail, but the way how the gauge fixing is done on the lattice, there are several methods. There's one method which is called the best cream of copy, and the other which is called the lowest cream of copy. I have no time to discuss this here in detail. Now, to make a long story short, if you use the alternate, well, I mean, what I showed you was that the lattice result was in contradiction to the sum rule. Or when you use the alternative method, let me skip this because I have no time. It's a Kleber problem. When you use the alternative method for gauge fixing, then you find indeed the infrared exponent which you get also in the continuum, namely 1. And these are recent lattice calculations from last year. Now, one may wonder whether the gluon propagator has also changed, but the gluon propagator doesn't change at all. We saw quite good agreement between continuum and the lattice with the gluon propagator. But you can see the two methods of gauge fixing give both the same result for the gluon propagator. And the gluon propagator is much easier to calculate on the lattice than the Gauss propagator, because you have to invert this operator, and since you have eigenvalues of this operator which come close to zero, this is really a difficult problem. So, let me come back now to this gauge-fixed Hamiltonian. The Coulomb torque, I have not yet discussed, which arises here from this P parallel square. You see, it contains here this very ugly operator. Then this quantity mu contains the color charge of the Mapper fields, and in addition, the charge of the gluon fields. The gluons are charged in Young-Mitzi, contrary to QED, and this is the expression for their charge. F is the structure constant. Now let us consider this term for just the Mapper fields. The Mapper fields, they compute with the Fadier-Foucault operator, and then the Fadier-Foucault operator drops out. And when you take the expectation value of this quantity in the gluon sector, you get precisely the static quark potential. So what you get then is this expression. And when you calculate this in our variational approach, what you find then is shown here. It goes at small distances like the Coulomb potential, and asymptotically it goes linearly with the coefficient, which is the so-called Coulomb string tension. On the lattice, you find that this Coulomb string tension is about a factor of 2 to 3 larger than the Wilson string tension. And in fact, Zwanziger has shown vigorously that this Coulomb string tension is an upper bound to the Wilson string tension. You need this Coulomb string tension to have confinement, but it's not sufficient. So when you look at this potential, and let's do for purposes of the talk, make this factorization here, then you get in the Fourier representation of this potential, you get the goes from factor square over p square. Now in order to have a linearizing potential, this Fourier transform has to go like 1 over p to the 4. And this, then you see that this goes from factor has precisely to go like 1 over p. So the infrared exponent, which we got 1, is in fact, gives you in fact this linearizing Coulomb potential. And this goes from factor of course fulfills the horizon condition. Now, this horizon condition, we may ask what are the field configurations which are responsible for this horizon condition. And what we can show, let me for time, is what makes this, or what you can at least imagine the following. Since the two of the most one factors defined in this way, in order that this guy is infrared divergent, you need small eigenvalues of this operator. You have to come close to so-called Green of horizon. Now you may ask what are the field configurations which are close to the Green of horizon? And what it turns out, you can show some magnetic monopoles and center vortices. In fact, you can show that these objects are precisely on the Green of horizon. Now, what we have done here is a lattice calculation again for the Gauss form factor. It is the full calculation of the Gauss form factor which I have shown before. And then we use the method which I have explained yesterday to remove all center vortices from your ensemble of gauge field configurations. And if you do that, then you find this result. You find the Gauss form factor which is no longer infrared divergent. You lose the horizon condition, you lose confinement. So you see again here in the Coulomb gauge picture, there are confinement manifests itself in the infrared divergent Gauss form factor. The center vortices are responsible for this horizon condition. The same is true for the Coulomb gauge, for the Coulomb potential. This is the full potential. If you remove center vortices, it becomes flat. You lose the confinement part, but you keep the Coulomb part, the vortices part. And if you lose the projection on center vortices, you get only linearizing potential. So this is all consistent with what I have told you yesterday. Now, I told you that this Coulomb potential if this is linearizing, it is necessary for confinement, but not sufficient. Let's look at the Wilson loop. The Wilson loop is difficult. We know that just to have a little more in the deconfined and the area law in the confined regime. Now, this quality is difficult to calculate due to the path ordering in the continuum. On the lattices, it's trivial, but in the continuum, it's really difficult. What we did, we used the Weise-Schwinger equation for the Wilson loop, which is derived in supersymmetric Young-Mills theory. And in fact, it's valid only in supersymmetric Young-Mills theory, but there it's exact, because then we have cancellation of vortex contributions and propagator contributions. Here, it's certainly an approximation and maybe even a good approximation, I don't know, but we use this Weise-Schwinger equation to calculate the Wilson loop in pure Young-Mills theory. And from this Wilson loop, we extracted the potential. But what we find, the full potential was this one, and the parabolic one is shown here with the black curve. When you subtract these two curves from each other, you find indeed a linearizing part. Unfortunately, the way we solve this Weise-Schwinger equation is we convert it into an eigenvalue equation. And by this method, we are restricted to rather small distances, because if we go to further distances, then the lowest eigenvalue becomes unbound. But in the regime where we can use our method, we really find a linearizing potential here from the Wilson loop. Now I come to the Tuft loop, which I mentioned already yesterday. The Tuft loop is easier to calculate in the continuum than the Wilson loop. So let's look at the Tuft loop. What is the Tuft loop? The Tuft loop is defined by an operator, which I call here capital B. And it's defined by its computation relation with the Wilson loop operator. If you change the order between the Wilson loop operator and the Tuft loop operator, then you pick up a non-trivial center element if the two loops from the Wilson loop and from the Tuft loop are linked non-trivially. So it's exponential of the Gaussian linking number. As Tuft has shown, the expectation value of this operator shows an area law in the deconfined regime and the parameter law in the confined regime. So this is opposite to the Wilson loop. Now, Tuft gave the definition of this operator by this computation relation and used the lattice to show further relation for this operator. You can, in fact, derive also a continuum representation for this operator, which was done here in this paper. And the continuum representation is the following. You have in the exponent the momentum operator, which represents the electric field. It's a canonical formulation, and the quality here is the gauge potential of the gauge of a central vortex. Now, let me write down this gauge potential. Remember, central vortices were closed flux lines in three-dimensional magnetic flux lines. Now, you can write this central vortex as integral over the surface enclosed by the loop. So let me write here my surface element, and let me call the surface sigma, and a vector on the surface which goes through this element epsilon, then I can write this as d sigma y in the delta of x minus y, and then there is something here in front of, let me call this quantity alpha. Now the point is, the quantity alpha which you have here has the property that e to the alpha gives you the center element. And for this reason, alpha has to be 2 times two times the so-called covariates. And for SU2, this covariate is defined by given by one times the generator of the compound algebra. Now, when you take this representation of the gauge field and plug this in here, you can do the integral over R3, and you are left with an integration over the surface of the electric field. And then you get, in fact, what I have mentioned yesterday, that the Tuff loop measures the electric flux through the loop compared to the Wilson loop, which measures the magnetic flux. Now, center vortex field I have defined yesterday has this property that the Wilson loop gives the center element if these two loops are not fully linked. Now, this operator, what this operator does is basically the following: it acts on the wave function, it adds a center vortex field to the argument of your wave function. And this is exactly the same as in quantum mechanics when you act with the translation operator on your wave function, you shift the argument in your wave function, where you have e to the I here, the momentum operator. Remember that the electric field operator is the momentum operator here in the gauge field. So it's quite natural to understand this relation. Now we have calculated then the expectation of the Wilson loop, of the Tuft loop, with our variational wave function, and you find in fact the parameter law, which was done here in this paper. Now let me come to the quark sector. How much time do you have?
22 minutes.
22 minutes, oh my god. Let me come to the quark sector. When it comes to the quarks, we have to add the Hamiltonian of the quarks interacting with the gauge field. And then we also have to include, you have to include here the charge, the color charge of the quark field. Then you can extend your variational calculation also to the gluon sector. Remember, we have this potential here, which is really important. The quark wave function which we use has the following form. It's a kind of BCS type wave function, however, it contains also the coupling to the gluon field. So we have in the exponent here a scalar kernel S times beta is the Dirac matrix, then another kernel V which multiplies the coupling to the quark field, the standard coupling which you have also in the QCD Hamiltonian, and then we have a second coupling term where you have not only alpha but also beta with another variational kernel. Now, the point is why we include this kernel. It is really funny when you include this kernel. You find in your variational equation that all UV divergences here exactly cancel. When you ignore these terms, then you have the BCS wave function which were used previously by these people. Now, due to the variation with respect to these variational kernels, it turns out the equation for V and W you can explicitly resolve in terms of the variational kernels for this S and omega from the gluon sector. And then you are basically left with a complicated quark gap equation for this variational kernel S. And as I pointed out already, the important point is that you have a strict cancellation of all UV divergences in this equation. Now we can solve this equation. Let me skip this, how we did this. This is the state variation of kernels V and W. But this is scalar kernel. The scalar kernel goes to one in the infinite, and then, of course, because of isotropic freedom, it has to vanish in the UV. As the dash curve is when you neglect the coupling of the gluons to the quarks in the wave function, that is when you use the pure BCS wave function. So you may think that the difference is not so remarkable, however, it's really remarkable for the quark condensate. This is the effective mass which we get. The point is, without this coupling, of the cross to the gluons in the wave function, you get a quadrant inside which is much too small. While with the coupling included, you can adjust the coupling power such that you get precise and the logical value of the quark condensate. Now let me come to finite temperature. You can extend this approach to finite temperature in the standard way using the canonical ensemble by making some ansatz for the density operator of the canonical ensemble, let's say at the moment here for magnesium. This was done here in this paper, these two papers, but I will not talk about that because there is a better way to finite temperature in this approach. And this is the approach I have presented yesterday in the exercises, where you compactify your spatial manifold and the temperature is introduced as the inverse length of your compactified spatial axis. I may have explained this in detail yesterday, so I will not say much about this approach now. Important point is you need no ansatz for the density matrix. Temperature is introduced here by the compactification of one spatial dimension, and then you have to solve the Hamiltonian on this spatial manifold. And the crucial point is that the whole partition function is then given by the ground state energy of this Hamiltonian on this manifold. Now, this approach was used for Yang-Mitzi at finite temperature in this paper. The Polyakov group was calculated in this paper, and the dual quark condensates was calculated here recently in this paper. So I will confine myself here in this talk for time reason on this Polyakov group. Now, the Polyakov group you have seen several times during this talk. Professor Pisarski gave a very extensive discussion of this object. This quality is most easily calculated in continuum theory if you go to so-called Polyakov gauge, where you choose the temporal gauge field, time independent, and diagonally Karl space. Then in SU2, this Polyakov group is then given by this quantity. And what you see here, if you confine yourself to the so-called fundamental modular region of this gauge, then the Polyakov group is a unique function of your field, which is constant and diagonal. Then we can show that at least for SU2 and SU3, instead of using the Polyakov group for precisely its expectation value as order parameter for confinement, you can also use the Polyakov group of the expectation value or the expectation value itself. This was shown by Pavlovsky and collaborators. Now I use this to get the order parameter for confinement. And having said this here, this that we can use also the expectation value of this temporal gauge itself as order parameter in this gauge here, then the simplest way to get the order parameter is you do a background field calculation to calculate the effective potential of this background field, temporal background field in Polyakov gauge. I mean, this has been done many years ago. It is now what you get. It also has been done in perturbation theory. And the result is this one here. Of course, in perturbation theory, the minimum of the potential is at the zero gauge field. Then the Polyakov group is 1, you are in the deconfined phase. This is so-called Weiss potential, which actually was first calculated here by these people, Ross, Pisarski, and Jaffe, but they somehow hided the calculation in the appendix, so Weiss got the credit for that. So what I would like to do, I would like now to use the Hamiltonian approach to calculate this potential non-perturbatively. I use this compactified approach, I compactify here the 3-axis, and I put my background field along the compactified 3-axis. Okay? because the background field belongs here, I'm compactified axis, you can just get rid of it, has no effect. Then it turns out in the Hamiltonian approach, the effective potential can be very easily obtained. And what you have to do is, you have to minimize your expectation value of the Hamiltonian under the constraint that the expectation value of the field equals the background field. And then the minimum is just the effective potential, and you can write it as a spatial volume times an energy density. So the background, the effective potential is basically the energy density calculated under this constraint. If you are interested in the derivation of this result, go to Weinberg's second volume of quantum field theory. He explains this very nicely. Now, when we do a background field calculation, it's most conveniently done here using the so-called background gauge, where we have the covariant derivative with the background field acting on the gauge field equal to zero. And so what we have to do here with this approach, we have to calculate the energy density on this partially compactified spatial manifold in the presence of the background field. Now, the energy density in the end turns out to be quite simple. What you do, you calculate the expectation value of the Hamiltonian, you derive your variational equation, the Gluon gap equation, and then you insert the Gluon gap equation into the energy function. And then the energy function simplifies quite a lot. And what we obtain is in our approximation is a very simple expression. The energy density is given by omega the Gluon energy minus the ghost loop, which I have shown before. Now, when you want to have the background field, the only thing which you have to do, you have to replace the momentum by a shifted momentum, where the momentum along the compactified axis is shifted by the background field, A, which is the vector in color space, and this vector sigma here is the root of the group, the gauge group. I mean, I have no time to explain this in more detail, how you arrive at this result, but it is straightforward. But you can also explicitly show that this potential defined in this way has the correct periodicity, which Professor Pisarski was talking about yesterday. And then what we do, we take just our zero temperature variational solution, which we got before, from the variation from our calculation, plug this in and calculate this function of this background field. Okay? So this is a straightforward calculation to do. Now, before I give you the full design, let me consider some simple limited cases. First, let me ignore the ghost loop. So my energy density is thus given by kind of quasi-particle expression for the gluons, this omega being this gluon energy which was infrared divergent and asymptotically going like the photon energy. And let me first consider omega given by just the photon energy, that is by the UV limit, and then by the infrared limit. And then I will take the sum as an approximation to the so-called Rieber formula, which we have seen fits the variational result quite nicely. Thus, if you choose omega, for omega its UV value, then you recover the rise potential. This, of course, you expect. Should come with no surprise. If you take, however, the infrared behavior of your gluon energy and you calculate this effective potential, then you get a potential which is shown here and which has the minimum at the center symmetric point. When you calculate the product of the loop from this minimum, it vanishes. You have the confined phase. And now let me go one step further. Let me use for the gluon energy just the sum of its
UV and its infrared behavior. Then I have just to add up the two potentials which I have shown before, and then you can analytically determine the critical temperature given by the square root of 2 times the cube of mass over pi. Now if you plug in the lattice value for the cube of mass, you get a transition temperature of 485 mV, which of course is much too high. However, you can easily show that this increase in the temperature comes due to the neglect of the ghost group. Now when you include the ghost group, then you have to do the calculations numerically. And this is the potential which you get for SU2. It really shows the second order phase transition and the critical temperature which you expect, again plugging in the cube of mass, which you see on the lattice of 880 mV, is 267 mV, which is quite recent. Now for SU3, you can do the calculation very easily by noticing that the SU3 group consists of 3 SU2 subgroups, which are characterized by the 3 non-zero positive roots of the SU3 group. So we have basically to add up three potentials, effective potentials from the SU2 group. Oh yeah, that's good. So you have to add up these three potentials. Then what you find for SU3, of course, then you have a two-dimensional plot, because you have, for SU3, you have two generators in the Cartan algebra, taken as T3 and TH. Now, why is the variable along the generator T3? X, and why is the variable along the generator, component along the generator T8? Now what you this is the potential below TC and above TC, and what you see in both cases, the minimum occurs always if you cut along this line y equal to 0. You have here the minimum and here you also the minimum. You can also show that you have the correct periodicity property, which you should have, and which was discussed yesterday by Professor Pizarski. Now when you make a cut here along this axis and you show that this potential, then you find this potential which clearly has a first order phase transition, and the temperature we expect here is 283 mV. However, I should say, we have used here the SU2 variational solutions, so this calculation is not really consistent. But still, I mean, the is the right order. Okay. Now, these are the results. You can compare these other calculations from the renormalization group flow equations. These people have recently improved their calculations by including fluctuations, but I mean, our calculations are mean field calculations, and we should compare with their mean field calculations, and I think we are even better than these calculations.
I think, of course, the major problem is that your critical temperature for SU3 is larger than in SU2, which is not really what you would expect from mechanisms. Okay, there are lattice results, but in addition, there is an intuition which is telling you that there should be lower temperature for SU3 pure HD or than SU2.
I absolutely agree, but as I mentioned, we have here used the SU2 variational solution, so we have not really gotten self-consistent.
I'm sorry, can you explain why you expect TC is lower for SU3 than SU2?
Yes.
I have no idea why.
I have an idea. If you look on the lattice results, the confinement is phenomenological. You get the confinement when the energy density is fixed of the order of 0.6 GeV per Fermi cube. Okay. Now, the mass spectrum in the SU3 and SU2 HD is different. So you have much more states.
I don't understand why you should have constant energy density.
Because when you look on the lattice,
independent of the number of degrees of freedom.
When you look on the lattice results, this is exactly the case. This is incredible. So okay. The energy density in the pure gauge theory is the same as in the full QCD at the transition.
And what is your prediction for an infinite number of colors then? Zero.
The predictions of the infinite number of color. No, because this temperature is saturated.
Okay, I think we have to postpone this discussion for later.
Listen to me. We have also included the forks, but these are preliminary calculations are not yet published, and in this calculation we have left out the ghost loop. So I mean the critical temperatures. Or supercritical temperatures are certainly not realistic. So what you see here is the Polyakov loop for pure SV2 gauge theory. When you include the quarks, comes the crossover. You see here for SV3, the Polyakov loop, it has certainly, you see the first order character here, the second order character of the confined phase partition. And the gain, of course, to get crossover when you use the quarks. Now, what instead of using the Polyakov loop, you can in principle use any quantity which transforms non-trivially under the center of the gauge group as an order parameter. And there was this work by Gattringer. I learned yesterday that we have also done some work in this direction. You calculate the quark condensate with certain boundary condition, and then you can show that this corresponds to loops winding around the compactified temporal dimension in the finite temperature gauge theory. Plus some fluctuations, and it's not, I mean, the equivalence between this so-called Dewey quark condensate and the Polyakov loop is not one-to-one, but basically what we include, not only the Polyakov loop, but also fluctuations of this loop. So anyway, to make a long story short, what you can do, you can calculate the quark condensate with generalized boundary condition. Remember for the finite temperature field theory and all the temperatures given by L capital L inverse, you had antiperiodic boundary conditions for the quark fields. Now if you generalize these boundary conditions to the arbitrary phase, calculate the condensate for an arbitrary phase, and then you integrate over this phase with this weight, then you get the so-called rest Polyakov loops, which wind precisely n times around the compactified temporal direction. Now what you can also show is that you can this phase absorb an imaginary chemical potential. Now in our approach we can easily also calculate this quantity. We get an imaginary, or in our case the chemical potential comes with an imaginary part. And now since we have an imaginary chemical potential, we get a real phase change in our compactified momentum. What we did, we calculated here this dual condensate in our variational approach, and we just showed you the result for the condensate as function of the temperature and the phase. And then the here's the quark condensate, the dual quark condensate, and we expect from this some supercritical temperatures given here by these figures. So I mean these are still preliminary calculations they are not we can still improve on that, but still what we at least see, I think we get quite values for this transition temperatures. So let me conclude. In the last talk here, I have presented the variational approach to QCD, where we solve the Schrödinger equation of QCD by means of the variational principle. I have demonstrated that this approach really gives a decent description of the infrared sector. The comparison with the lattice result, in my opinion, quite remarkable, given the simplicity of the ansatz. Then I have discussed finer temperature, Young-Yield theory, where the temperature is introduced by compactifying the spatial dimension. In this approach, the complete finer temperature theory is encoded in the ground state of the theory defined by this spatial manifold. I have used this approach to calculate the effective potential of the Polyakov loop. We get also the right order of the confinement phase transition in the pure Young-Yield sector. Then we put the force, we get the crossover as we should. And finally, I calculated this chiral or quantum.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So the stage is open for questions.
The question is about the horizon condition. Yeah. Does it come out from Kubo or Hilbert confinement criteria or something totally different?
The confinement, horizon condition, you will get, I mean, this is consistent with their confinement criterion. So this is basically one-to-one correspondence.
So it's coming from the
RST market? It comes basically from the Kripov horizon, if you like. Oh. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But this is one-to-one.
Are there more questions? Yes, stop.
Could I see your plot of the Polyakov loop versus temperature?
It's a Polyakov loop. Okay. So this goes in the new direction.
Yeah. I just want to make the trivial point that I stressed in my talk that in our model, as in yours, the loop goes to one much quicker than indicated by the normalized loop on the lattice, which may be due simply to some sort of non-trivial lattice renormalization effect. But then I also wanted to ask you, what's the value for three colors at TC plus? Is that 1/2 or?
What do you mean?
What is the value of the Polyakov loop at TC? Just above
5.
It's first order.
You mean this one here?
That one right there.
This is roughly 1/2. Yeah.
I see. I just want to, as I mentioned in my talk too, a value near 1/2, particularly at large ends, is very interesting. That may indicate the presence of a novel transition of a gross Witten Wadian type.
Okay.
So I'm just very interested to see that.
Very close to 1/2. Thank you.
How this is changing with the number of colors? If you increase the number of colors, what happens with this gap?
It goes to 1/2. It's 1/2.
So the limit is 1/2 when NC goes to infinity.
NC. Yeah. So it's just interesting to see it. Near 1/2 with three colors.
All right. More questions? If not, thank you, Professor Reinhardt, again.